So, good morning, everyone. How's DevCon going? Good? Everybody's awake?
Yeah.
I'm surprised. Thank you very much for taking time to come this morning. For those of you who haven't caught on already, I'm BDL. Among other things, I've been serving for several years as president of Software in the Public Interest. It has become our habit each year at DevConf to have a SPI, Birds of a Feather session. Mostly as an opportunity for us to report on the status of SPI and to answer any questions. We don't have any really significant new information to report except for some brief updates on financials and so forth. Out of curiosity, how many of you are not SPI members? You should fix that today. We'll explain how in a little bit. So what I'll do is I'll just briefly run through who the current board members and officers are. We just had a board of directors election. It was pointed out since we arrived here at DevConf that we oopsed and made a small mistake and forgot to have a re-election or election of officers at the first board meeting after the board election. We kind of lost track of this because while we did have an election of new board members this year, it did not involve an actual vote, because the number of candidates and the number of available positions did not require one. We'll talk just a little bit about how SPI came to be and what the history is, what the list current sort of logo cloud of associated projects looks like. Probably spend a little more time talking about financial status, and then we can take whatever questions people would like to ask. This is the current composition of the board of directors and officers list. Those that are italicized are not present. As was already mentioned, Martin Zobel-Hellas was here for much of the week, but he had to leave after the conference dinner last night, so he's not present today. So I guess here in the room today from the board, I'm here as president, Ertz here as vice president, and Martin is our current secretary. And I guess everyone else is not here. A couple of notes. As time goes on, the board is slowly becoming more diversified amongst the associated projects. It's not quite as purely Debian looking as it once was, and I'm actually really pleased by that. I'm glad that representatives from some of our other associated projects are taking the step to take a more substantial role in SPI. So what is SPI? Well, it stands for Software in the Public Interest. It's organized as a charitable nonprofit organization in the United States. It was originally created when the Debian project became large enough that there was a need to have a place that could legally hold assets on behalf of the Debian project in the US. And fortunately, those who created Software in the Public Interest were forward thinking enough to realize that this was a service that other projects might need too, not just Debian. So instead of creating it as the Debian Foundation or something like this, it was created as a more generic Software in the Public Interest charity. And as you'll see in a moment, we now provide similar services to a broad range projects in the free and open source software world. This is the organization that holds Debian funds in the US and other assets like trademarks, domain names, and among other things, the copyrights of Debian's logo. SPI was founded as a nonprofit corporation in the state of New York in June of 1997. In 1999, the Internal Revenue Service recognized Software in the Public Interest as qualifying to for charitable status under the 501c3 part of the U.S. tax code. The important part of this is that donations coming from individuals and companies in the United States may be offered some advantageous tax benefits. That, of course, depends on individual financial considerations. And then, as I already mentioned, while SPI was originally created to serve a Debian need, it does now serve many different significant free software projects. This is the first of a couple of slides I have with the logos of the various projects that are associated with SPI. And one of the things I think that differentiates SPI from other financial and legal hosting umbrellas for various free and open source software projects is that our projects associate themselves with SPI. They're not actually, they don't legally become part of SPI. One of the benefits of this is that it's okay for projects that are associated with SPI to also be associated with other similarly structured charitable organizations in other parts of the world. So in the Debian case, for example, Debian has other organizations in different countries in Europe and in Latin America and so forth that can also accept donations and hold assets on behalf of the Debian project in those places. So when you see the numbers representing the financial assets that SPI holds for Debian, that's not all of Debian's assets. That's just the assets that are being held on behalf of the Debian project in the US. Here's another big thing. A couple things you might notice in here. There's more than one Linux distribution. Arch Linux is also involved, as are some others. We have multiple database projects associated. So this really is a very broadly structured and very diversely connected organization. Any questions about the associated projects list or any of the other things I've talked about so far? So financially, I pulled the numbers from the sort of annual report, treasurer's report, which is through the end of June. At that time, the total money being held by Software in the Public Interest was just over $841,000 US, of which more than $700,000 is being held in trust for our associated projects, and approximately $128,000 was being held in SPI's general reserves. Honestly, that's the highest the general reserves have ever been. It's half again as large as it was a year earlier. A year earlier, that was in the low $80,000 range. And this is the reason that I'm really quite convinced that we are at the point in time where it's okay for us to spend some of the money from the general reserves taking on more of SPI's routine tasks as things that we acquire some paid professional help to do. And we'll talk about that maybe some more after the formal part of the presentation. But as you can see, the vast majority of the funds that are being held by SPI are not really SPI's money. That's money that we're holding in trust on behalf of the associated projects. And this is what the balances for those look like. Intriguingly still, something like a third of all of that money is one way or another being held on behalf of Debian and DevCon. As you can see, the Debian earmark itself, which is right there, is still sitting at something above $224,000. This is at the end of June, again. And there were funds still associated with the DevCon 14 earmark, and quite a bit of funds for the DevCon 15 earmark. I'm sure that by the time we finish with this DevCon and close out the associated expense transactions and so forth, that those balances will be substantially different. But for DevConf, what we usually try to do for this Birds of a Feather session is take the SPI annual numbers from the end of June so that we have sort of a way to look at them year to year. And those numbers are slightly up from this time last year, but it's not really a very dramatic difference. And Debian's balance held by SPI has remained reasonably steady over the last couple of years. And I guess if we go ahead and look at some of the others, there's substantial balances being held on behalf of other organizations. LibreOffice is another good example. As I think everyone knows, there's now this thing called the Document Foundation, which is the primary umbrella organization for the LibreOffice activities. But what we've discovered in the past is that moving funds back and forth across international borders just to aggregate sums in one place is stupid because we end up paying international exchange fees and all of this. So this is another example of a place where we're happy to continue holding those funds in trust for that project, and when they have things they need to spend money on in the U.S., they can ask SPI to disperse those funds, and we don't have quite as many international funds transfer fees. And in fact, the LibreOffice earmark is down from last year because we paid a couple of bills in, on their behalf for travel reimbursements from people from the U.S. or something like that. And this is the last of that list. As you can see, PostgreSQL continues to be one of the other projects that we're holding substantial assets on behalf of, and in fact, we have one of our board members represents that project. And if you look at this list, there are a couple of projects that are essentially defunct. And one of the sort of legal challenges that we'll have to address at some point is that in our associated project agreements, we have historically not been good about including any language to cover what happens when a project ceases to be active or disappears. Under the IRS rules, we understand that we can't transfer funds out to anything other than another charity. So if a project, for example, back in the old days, we held funds on behalf of the GNOME project. When the GNOME Foundation was formed, it had a similar IRS tax status. It was easy for us to take the balance we were holding and transfer it to the new charity to continue to use on behalf of GNOME, particularly since that was also an organization in the U.S. But, you know, if we decide at some point that, you know, OS Unix really is dead and gone, what do we do with the $2.92? And, you know, because these funds that are being held in trust for the various projects were given to us by the donors with an explicit earmark saying they wanted the funds used for that project, the fact that we lack some explicit language in our associated project agreements from that era to say, if this project ever goes away, that will revert to being SQI general funds or something like that. I think at some point there's a legal question to be resolved about what exactly do we need to clean up some of these little balances, and a couple of cases, not so little balances from projects that are just not active anymore. So, I asked at the beginning how many of you are not SQI members. I really do encourage everyone to go apply and become a member. Being a base level member of SPI really requires nothing in your part except an expression of interest. There is a separate category for contributing members, and anyone who is here at a DevConf undoubtedly qualifies for contributing member status and should ask for it and will probably be granted it. The only real difference is that contributing members have the right to vote, and in the past, that's primarily been the opportunity to vote each year for who will represent the membership on the board of directors. But one of the things I would personally like to drive forward in the next year is to finally get around to fixing the issues that exist in the organization's bylaws. And to do that, we will at some point have to actually have a vote of the contributing membership to approve the new bylaws. So this year may actually afford an opportunity to, you know, vote more than once. And this is where you can go to, I believe that's still the right URL. So that's still the right URL, Mark, and do, you know. Somebody type fast and tell me. I didn't think to check that. It's close enough.
You can go to members.spiinc.org.
Members.spi-inc.org. Okay.
And that will give you a link to the app to apply for.
I'll fix that later.
So, how do I find out if I am a member? Because I might be.
If you're not sure, you can ask me and I can check.
Okay.
Otherwise, if you know what email address it was, you can go and try and log in, and there's a password reset option.
The usual things, I guess. But since we're all here, yes. Just asking. And in terms of getting involved, our board meetings are monthly. The schedule and agenda are announced in advance. The agenda is published on our website under the corporate agendas part of the website. And those meetings are held in the open on the hash SPI channel on irc.oftc.net. So, feel free to come and observe our board meetings. We do actually offer the opportunity at the start of each board meeting when the board members are identifying themselves and binding their real-world identities to their IRC NICs for the purpose of minutes. We offer the opportunity for anyone observing the board meeting to also identify themselves and be recorded in the minutes as having attended the meeting. So another opportunity to have your name recorded for posterity on a website somewhere. Our discussions are held on several mailing lists. You can learn more about those on the website. There's a general access mailing list, one that's for contributing members only. There's a board of directors list that we use for instances we can get away with, because that one is relatively private. But I certainly encourage all of you to use the rest of this session and the rest of the time that we're here at DevCon to reach out to those of us who are present and ask any questions you'd like or bring up any interesting topics directly. With that, the sort of formal part of the presentation that I put together is over, and we'll be happy to take any questions that anyone has.
Yeah.
So I have a question. I'm Andre Suri, and with my KSK rollover design team heads right now, and I sent a question that was raised by ICANN, if SPI certification authority could cross-sign the new key signing key for Arudzo, we much appreciate it.
Right, we got that question, and I told him that I'm not answering it alone and I need to discuss with people. I sent a mail about that to SPI private, got one or two answers, and have a few people running around here at DevComs that I really want to talk to with,
okay.
But didn't have yet.
So,
but the general response I got was that it's positive. We need to talk about a few handlings of the SPICA and stuff, but
okay.
Then we should be able to do it.
Okay. Do you think that you'll get to the point where you have all the answers you need before the end of DevCon, or do you know?
I need to grab some guidance and talk to him, so maybe, possibly, yes.
Okay, would be good if that could happen,
So did I understand correctly that SPI runs a CA?
Yes.
Yes.
You run one, it's not in the browser by default, because it's a bit above our handlings currently, what you need to do for that. But we have one, and at least in Debian it's installed, we use a CA certificates package, otherwise you need to get it yourself. But yeah,
so
we run one, every project could take certificates out of it if it's just us.
So it's not in the root trust store because
it's not
signed by a public CA? That's
it's complicated, but the short version is we run a CA, it's not recognized by everybody, but Debian, and I think most Debian derivatives
have
distribute us in their CA certificates packages.
Cool.
So I thought, I guess you were at the Let's Encrypt session.
Yes.
Perhaps we can get it cross-signed by another certification authority.
We really haven't even thought about that very hard yet, but
yeah.
It certainly seems like that would make sense. I would think that somehow, I'm certainly personally very excited about Let's Encrypt, and I would think that as they become ready to sort of deal with the rest of the world, that's a conversation we certainly would look forward to having.
Some kind of managed CA from them or something, or that we have a patch where we can do it. I don't think Let's Encrypt is really taking off and really getting good, but I hope that we want to run it complete on CA.
Right.
Because there are lots of constraints and problems coming up if you run it on CA.
Yeah, as you heard in the presentation the other day, and I ran into this actually in a different but similar context related to the UEFI secure boot. And the issue there was, you know, who's going to be willing to run a CA? And in the end, the CA that exists for UEFI Secure Boot is owned and operated by Microsoft. And everyone uses them to obtain signatures and all of that. And as long as they continue to run that in a trustworthy sort of way and allow whoever needs it to have access to the service, that's just fine. But the nonprofit organization that was developing the specifications realized that it was well beyond their capabilities to be able to run a CA or to afford to have somebody else do a dedicated one. So I'm really, the Let's Encrypt thing really excites me because a core group of organizations that are highly motivated to do it and do it well is doing that work. We've been running one because we needed one, not because we really wanted to run a CA. And in the meantime, let's do all the right things, but absolutely, I would hope that we, you know, connect ourselves in whatever the appropriate way turns out to be with Let's Encrypt.
Peter, I guess we might have some tips which CA we should talk to, which would be willing to cross-sign the SPI CA. So
as Eric says, once they're online, you know, the idea that they might cross-sign us themselves is... Okay. This is also the question of, you know, I don't want them to cross-sign us just because we're a nice charity. I mean, we ought to have a very serious conversation about what does it mean to run a CA or an associated CA or cross-sign CA, and that's all reasonable, great. If it seems like too big a burden, then I think we'll decide. If they're very successful, maybe we don't have to take ours to the next level. Maybe we just use theirs. I haven't really thought that through.
Currently, I didn't want to cross-sign ourselves, to be honest, if I would be a CA, because it's completely different from many CA standards that we are running it. I think we are doing it in a secure way and stuff, but it's, in my opinion, not the optimum way you can could actually do it. It's good for our project, it's good for the things we are having, and it worked, and we never had a big problem with it, at least not that I got out of, except that we are not in any main browser. But if you can jump on Let's Encrypt or something, you will do that.
I would submit that there will just be more projects in the future that would benefit from a CA that is philosophically aligned with the projects that SPI represents. So, especially true with respect to cloud computing and pockets of cloud computing that are philosophically aligned with SPI.
And then I think the big question is, do we end up believing we're fully philosophically aligned with the way Let's Encrypt is running their CA, or does there continue to be some delta? And that will have to be part of our decision process in the future. We've been paying lots of attention, and I'm looking forward to seeing them come online, and I can't wait to start using their services for some of my own personal servers and so forth, and therefore I'm sure we'll all have the opportunity to learn how that works and think about how that should interact with SPI. Yes, we do run a CA, kind of quietly. Our associated projects, many of them are taking advantage of
that. Debian has used them, and I don't know if they still have any because they got them sponsored by Gandhi in the past, recent one. OFTC is using it quite a lot for all of the servers. So, yeah.
So just to finish out the comment, I don't want to beat it to death.
That's okay.
I have a previous affiliation with a company called GlobalSign, which is in the root trust store for all major operating systems, which I could probably arrange for a co-signing. They could probably sign or something.
Again, that would be great. And again, the issue is just that we have to understand what their normal expectations for a cross-sign project are, and we have to consciously decide if we're going to do more groups. Because we're at a point now where the things we really needed to accomplish are well handled with the current setup. And so with an activity like Let's Encrypt underway and making progress in what we think is the right direction, doing a lot of extra work to beef up RCA might or might not really be a great investment of time. But I think we'll get a chance to see that over the next 3 or 4 months as they come online. We're certainly not going to abandon our CA suddenly for no reason, but the reason it exists is because there wasn't anything like Let's Encrypt around that we could take advantage of. So. But I think in particular, being able to get certificate, wildcard certificates, is one of the things that none of the free as in beer CAs have wanted to support in the past. And it's in Peter's presentation, we've got something they'll get to that isn't necessarily part of the initial offering, too. So I guess we'll just have to see how that works out. Other questions?
Yeah. Yes. About the DevConf. In some countries, it's easier to create a local trusted organization of Debian. But for example, next year we need a lot of support of SPI. What can we get from SPI? SPI can sign contracts on behalf of South African DevConf.
I mean, as long as it's okay for a U.S. nonprofit to be signing those contracts, I mean, as long as the person on the other side of the contract thinks that's okay, I don't have any problem with it, and I don't think Michael would either. So, I think we can probably do the right things. We were talking before the session started today about handling funds, and the use of SPI as a way to route funds to a conference that's happening in another country actually started at DevConf 6, when there was a huge problem trying to get a contribution from a major U.S. corporation into a personal bank account in Mexico. And the resolution of that in the end was that I suggested as a last desperate measure, oh, well, can you get it to SPI and we'll figure it out from there. The we'll figure it out was that SPI reimbursed my personal credit card for the way we handled the rest of the expenses in Mexico. All of that's ancient history, it doesn't matter, but since then, what we've done is U.S. corporations, we've offered them the opportunity to make their donations through SPI, and then we've suggested that money coming from places outside of the U.S. probably should not route through the U.S. unless there's really some compelling reason to do that. And so, for example, when DevConf was being held in Portland, it was easy for those funds to route through SPI. When it's being held in Switzerland, it's a little bit harder, but it wasn't difficult because they had a local organization with a local bank account. We could do one or two large transfers and not have lots and lots of little international funds transfer fees. So the only thing I would ask is that we have a conversation about this with Michael, the treasurer, and make sure we understand what the best way to handle the actual financial transaction logistics are so that we don't end up paying a lot of international funds transfer fees. But in terms of providing a legal entity that can be contractually obligated on behalf of Debian and DevConf, I think it's okay for SPI to play that role. Again, we have to look at the terms of any specific contract and make sure they don't violate our legal constraints, but I can't imagine that being true from DevConf. So.
Thank you.
Sure.
Can SPI open a bank account in the target country?
Can SPI open a bank account in the target country? Maybe, but I'm not sure it's a good idea.
Okay.
The problem is that if SPI does that, then all of a sudden those are assets held by a U.S. nonprofit, and that means that the tax rules about it get conflated by the rules of the separate countries. And I'm afraid our bookkeepers I'm afraid their heads would explode. And I would be afraid we would find ourselves in a situation that really wasn't good locally. I don't know. I almost would rather see somebody run and manage the primary accounting for some Debian activity happening outside of the U.S. I'd almost rather do it through a personal account with good record keeping than to try and have SPI hold an account there. I'm not someone who should be giving legal or financial advice in countries outside of the U.S., maybe not even in the U.S., though, so take that all with a grain of salt. Other questions? You must have at least one, sir.
So, it's interesting that you talked about the need for SPI possibly to have some paid level. I think SPI is certainly getting to the size and the stage now that would be very useful. I mean, essentially for such a important organization that's holding large amounts of assets for various projects, having to rely on volunteer effort and basically a group of people is something that may not be the most reliable way of doing it. So it'd be useful if you could sort of give an overview of where we could go with that, what sort of things we could look at, and how SPI as an organization can help bring that sort of professional paid help.
Yeah, so there's been, we've gone back and forth on this over the years, and I guess 3 or 4 years ago, we passed a resolution agreeing to spend some money acquiring specifically some assistance with bookkeeping and accounting services. And our treasurer did some investigation, found a firm he thought could provide services that were useful to make his life easier, and we began a relationship with them. And in all honesty, that relationship, I think, from where I sit, has seemed a little bit rocky. I don't think it got off really well, and then I think the people that were actually doing the workforce were not completely meeting our expectations. My understanding is that our treasurer recently had a meeting with the leader/ownership management team of that firm, and they've agreed to change the way they're interacting with us and do stuff in a way that's better for them. I don't really know much of the detail of what that means or what the changes are. So in parallel with this, I realized that, and this was largely due to inputs from people like Joshua Burkus, who for a while was providing us volunteer assistant treasurer services, doing things like managing the documentation trail and the logistics for our various associated projects involvement in Google Summer of Code, which actually for many of our associated projects, their largest annual financial transactions are the reimbursements coming through for travel with those mentors summit and the funds that are actually going to the students that are involved in working on their projects. So based on that, I realized that we actually have grown to the point where we probably need some administrative hours or a time, manpower above and beyond, quote unquote, just the bookkeeping that I thought we ought to try and address. So I thought about sort of two things in my personal history that provided some advice and guidance on this. One is that I've been involved with another US 501c3 nonprofit charitable organization for many years, and that's the Radio Amateur Satellite Corporation. And in AMSAT, there's a full-time paid office manager person as the only real employee of the corporation, and they outsourced some bookkeeping and accounting services so that the volunteer treasurer for the organization doesn't actually do anything in the sense of opening envelopes and depositing checks and managing financial transactions and reimbursements. That's all done either by the paid office manager or the contracted accounting firm that handles the books. What the treasurer is responsible for is getting the reports from the people doing the work and reviewing them and reporting on them in board meetings and being part of strategic discussions about what should happen with the funds that were available, and in effect sort of guiding the activities of the people being paid to do the work. So I have that as one model of how a successful large 501c3 in the U.S. operates. And then I remembered that at one point I was on the board of directors of the Consumer Electronics Linux Forum, CELF, before it folded in and became the Consumer Electronics Working Group at the Linux Foundation. And in the early days of CELF, the companies that started that organization actually contracted with a third-party management services firm to run the organization. And I believe, if I remember correctly, that was the company's called VTM. And they're still around, and they're in the business of basically providing a turnkey solution for running a nonprofit organization. And they did things like arrange for the logistics of the physical twice-a-year board meetings, one in Japan, one in the U.S. every year. They sent somebody to sit in the room and interact with the venue staff to make sure that the doors were unlocked and lights were turned on and the beverages were there for the break service at the right time. And they took minutes and wrote up the minutes and sort of acted as the person doing the work of the secretary and the treasurer for the organization. And they had, within their organization, the accounting resources to provide all of that just as a service, allowing the board members, all of whom were there as representatives of the different member companies, to focus again on sort of the strategic thinking and decision making associated with the project. And so with those two personal things in my experience as guidance, I started thinking about where could we go to get some help. Because the one thing I recognized is that I did not want to be, as a volunteer to SPI, responsible for the process of hiring and managing someone who just works for SPI. The overhead of being a people manager for an organization I'm a volunteer to was not appealing. But I didn't think anybody else on the board was really enthusiastic about this either. So what I tried to find was one or more places that we could go and have some kind of a contractual relationship with somebody else who would acquire the manpower, do the work, and sort of be responsible to us contractually. And the two places I've talked to recently about this are the Linux Foundation and the Software Freedom Conservancy. I reported briefly in the last board meeting and in the conversations on channel afterwards about the conversation with the Linux Foundation. But Linux Foundation is not a 501c3. They're a 501c6, which in the US tax code means that they're not a charity, they're a trade association. And that means that unlike a charity where you sort of receive donations and then independent of any of those donations, you have a board that decides what to do with those funds and what the strategic intent and direction of the organization should be. In a trade association, you have members who pay to play, and by paying to be there, they help to guide the strategic direction. And so trade associations exist for companies to collaborate on activities that support common strategies and development of new markets and so forth. So it's a different kind of organization, but I decided I didn't really care because what I have seen as a member of the board and as an observer of the Linux Foundation is that Jim Zemlin and his team are really good at hiring high quality people and motivating them to deliver outstanding performance in various tasks. And so the notion that I might be able to convince him to take some money from SPI to give us a third or half of a person's time to manage the activities at SPI, and that I could trust that, you know, someone who has the demonstrated ability to do good people management would be sort of watching those activities and worrying about the human resources aspects of it, was pretty appealing. The more we talked, though, the more I realized that there is sort of a, this is something I think the LF would be happy to do. I think they would give us a good rate. I think that they would feel good about helping out a C3 charitable organization. But it is absolutely true that there's a bit of a philosophical disconnect. I'm pretty confident that if they helped us manage our books, it would not be done using free software unless we made that an absolute requirement in the contract, for example. Because while they strongly support the Linux ecosystem, you know, they run around using Apple products and running proprietary software to run the business supporting free software activities around Linux. And that's perfectly okay. There's nothing wrong with that. But SPI has historically taken a much stronger philosophical stance on this. We've tried very, very hard to not use anything that was proprietary in our activities. And so I had the opportunity at OSCON to have a conversation with Karen Sandler and Bradley Kuhn from the Conservancy. And they pointed out that, in fact, their needs have been quite similar to SPI. They now have, I think, 3 full-time paid staff. And their transaction volume is really quite high because of some of the projects that are associated with the Conservancy. So they said, if you're looking for a place to go contract with to provide just some manpower, why not come talk to us, because we are philosophically almost entirely aligned. We also care about using free software for everything we do. And in fact, you, SPI, were willing in the last year to vote to provide up to $10,000 in sponsorship for our work on financial software and related processes to support our kinds of organizations. And even though we didn't get enough other sponsors to take your money and proceed with that work, you know, there's this huge convergence of interest here. Where we are right now is those are the conversations I've had. The next steps, I think, that need to occur are that we need to get Michael and others in it, you know, Martin, others in SPI that are involved in some of these routine processes together to discuss and plan, you know, what we really ought to do to take the way we operate through some transition to a new, better, capable of handling greater scale situation. And so, in fact, in conversation earlier this week, Zobel proposed that maybe what we needed to do is have something like an SPI financial processes sprint. And, you know, maybe there's the opportunity for us to get the right group of people together in one place to spend a couple of days working through this, figuring out, doing a better job of documenting so that we all understand what our current processes are, how they work, where the, what causes the heavy lifting, where's the workload, what makes it hard for us to continue to scale in a purely volunteer way. And maybe be able to make some decisions based on that about what to do next. So we have no concrete plans about, you know, when that might happen or who would be involved or anything. But that's my current thinking about how we move forward on this. And I feel good about this because after two or three or four years of thrashing a little bit and trying to think, you know, gee, shouldn't we be spending more money, getting more help? It feels to me like, you know, maybe we are starting to at least have a plan for how to get to a plan. So we'll see how that goes. And anyone here that has any thoughts or inputs or suggestions or wants to help with that, that would be great. But that's my current thinking about it. Other questions?
I think we have 3 minutes left.
We have a couple minutes left. There's time for at least one more. Neil, feel free if you have another one.
I think it might be useful at some point for us guys to look at payment processes and how we can accept donations. I mean, traditionally we've used click and pledge, I believe, and certainly seen some issues around there. It's specifically with how well it manages to deal with donations and the financial security behind that, and things like checks on credit cards to make sure things aren't being abused. So I know. Did SPI have a PayPal account set up, or was that one? Or so there has been some movement around there, but be useful to possibly look at that.
There was quite a bit of consternation about PayPal itself at one point in SPI's history. I personally and others involved with SPI over time have had reason to have PayPal accounts associated with other activities we're involved in that take money over the internet. And I, at least, personally, have learned quite a bit about sort of the best way to set up commercial bank accounts attached to PayPal accounts and arrange for automatic sweep of funds to get them out of PayPal and into your bank account where you control it and all that sort of stuff. And I'm really quite impressed with some of the aspects of PayPal's chargeback handling mechanism. And I think that's been one of the big concerns in the past. So I think as part of this whole idea of reviewing, maybe having a sprint around SPI's financial processes, it would be completely appropriate for us to review and consider whether the ways we currently allow folks to give us money is the right set. Another question that's come up a couple of times is, do we accept Bitcoin? And so far the answer is no. I don't have a problem with accepting Bitcoin philosophically, but from a practical standpoint, there are a bunch of questions and how it would actually be, you know, rendered and those assets tracked. If someone really wants us to pursue that, that's a project we'd have to engage in to go figure that out. Well, with that, I'm told we're out of time. Thank you very much for your time and attention. And if you have other questions, please feel free to catch any of us in the halls the next day or so, and we'll be happy to talk about other things. Thank you again.